Welcome back. Our ERC20 token is just about ready to go. In the previous unit, we fleshed it out with this minting logic. It's just allowing a separate contract to mint tokens. Now we need to build out this new minter contract. So the first thing we need to do is figure out how to get this minter contract to connect with this token. This is where we're going to teach you about interfaces. Let's begin by taking a look at the Brownie tests and seeing what's changed between last lesson and this lesson. Once we've coded this completely, the Brownie test should pass, but we've made a few changes to accommodate where we'd like to be by the end of this lesson. So you can see we're failing here on the test minter. What the tests have mostly done is assigned the minter contract role to the token, and instead of trying to call the mint function directly on the token, we're now trying to call it through the minter function. So, pretty easy. Let's open up our minter contract, which we haven't looked at in quite some time. Again, this is a very basic implementation of a smart contract that does nothing. There's a single function that when you reach it, it does nothing. This is as bare bones of a contract as we can get. But not to worry, by the end of this lesson, it's going to be live and minting successfully. So we mentioned that we need to communicate with this external smart contract. The way that Vyper does this is through interfaces. Interfaces are very similar to the concept of ABIs, which you might have seen, which is essentially just a set of definitions for how the smart contract should read and interpret the other smart contract. All smart contracts have these publicly available functions, but you can't derive them easily from the bytecode. So you can think of it as a map saying, here's the functions that exist and you're going to need to call, and here's how you should call them. Within Vyper, they are declared using the interface keyword. You are going to define the interface and then the name of the type of interface you're creating. And then indented beyond this is going to be just a list of all the functions that you can call, along with the parameters that are necessary to call it. And we'll walk through these parameters as we create it. Essentially, though, all the arguments that are passed to the function go within the parentheses, and anything that's returned, if it exists, has this arrow pointing to the type of return to expect, followed by one decorator to declare the state modification nature and whether you need to access it in a special way. So with our contract, there are very simple ways that you can actually call and import interfaces, but we're going to show how to create one from scratch. So we'll start by creating an interface for what we're going to call just a token. And the only function we really care about calling is this mint function. There are other functions on it which we might need to add to it, but you don't need to pass an exhaustive list of all the functions, just the ones that you're calling through the contract. So if we split our window so we can take a look at our token, we can see that when we call the mint function, this function is expecting a to address, which is an address, and an amount of tokens to mint, which is a uint256. So our interface simply needs to mention that when we call this mint function, it should expect these parameters, just like that. There's no return value, so we don't need to pass a return value. But we do need to tell it what kind of function it should be calling. And by this I mean, if you look here at the documentation, there's four different annotations you can pass. Payable means that you are planning to send Ethereum to this contract. You need to decorate that, otherwise it's not going to be assuming that the contract can accept money. Nonpayable means that you are able to access this contract and that this contract call might write or change the nature of the blockchain, so it might adjust some storage variables through the process. View and pure are in this class of non-modifying call types. If it's a view that says it can call the external function and the view means it can read the blockchain data, but it's not going to be changing it. And pure means that it's not even going to be reading blockchain data, so it's an even less intensive call. For our sake, we are going to be using the non-payable annotation because when it mints tokens, it needs to adjust its internal storage to reflect this new balance. So we will now pass this just by adding a colon and typing non-payable. This is all that we need to define the interface for our token for this particular contract. Some more things that we might want to do while we're going through this. We want to be able to call this token and just hard code it when we create our function. We did this similarly with our minter and owner addresses last time. We created state variables that said, this is the owner address, this is the minter address. Let's similarly create an initialization function, which will receive a token address, this token being the contract that will be the ERC-20 token. And when we initialize this contract, we're going to set the self.token, which is a state variable we're going to create, and mark it as a token at the address in question. So we notice that we're able to call the interface by using the interface name and then parentheses. We also can use this when accessing the storage variables, as mentioned here. It's a type annotation where when we were creating our storage variables previously, we marked them as an address or an unsigned integer. You can also just assign them directly as a, for us, it'll be a token. And when we instantiate it, we cast the address to the interface using its address. So up here in our storage variables, we'll create a storage variable called token. We'll make it public. And we're going to mark it as one of these token interfaces we created. So this here is perfectly legal and a proper way of instantiating this, passing the token, and storing this in our state variable. So all that's left to do now is actually call it. Instead of when we call this mint function just passing, which means this is a line of code that doesn't do anything, we're going to replace the pass function with a call to mint this token. So to access state variables, just like last time, we call self dot token, and this is going to bring up a token object. Now we can call any of these functions we've defined within this interface. At this point, we've only created a mint function. Call message sender and quantity. In quantity, we will go ahead and define right here as a uint256 of number of tokens we'd like to mint. Can change our documentation because it's no longer not implemented. We now have a param, which is quantity to mint. And now if all goes well, when we run our brownie test, we should see, forgot to decorate my initialization function as external facing. And now if all goes well, our minter function is going to pass through these tests. We're great. One last trick I'd like to show you. If you don't want to go through all this work to create an interface, there is a nice built-in shortcut within the Vyper command line tool. So to access this, I'm going to show off how we could pull the complete interface from the token. First up, I'm going to kick it up to Vyper 3. And here on the command line, I'm going to type Vyper hyphen F interface and then link to the Vyper file. And it's going to give me the full interface of this function. So view external minter, view external owner. This is a function that you can also use to import into Vyper, and Vyper can read this and use this as an interface for this token smart contract. There's a few other tricks that Vyper has to make it easy to work with interfaces, but this gets you all you need to know to begin communicating between smart contracts. We'll be back soon. Looking forward to chatting. Drop your questions in the comments.